Okay, we will start. Can I see more people coming? Yes. Good, so we can start. Okay. So, well, you know the colloquias are some special activity for ICTP, and for us it's very important to have a broader perspective on different aspects of physics and mathematics. And we try to invite top speakers, leaders in the field, to give us an idea of what that field is moving. And today we are very, very lucky to have Mina. It's Asimina Arvanitaki, as you say, but it's, we all call her Mina. She's, as everybody who knows her, is one of the rising stars in the field of theoretical physics. She's one of those young scientists that makes you feel that you're old, because, because she's so bright and knowledgeable and on top of everything that makes you, you appreciate that she's in one direction and you are in the other direction, in different slopes. And
don't listen to him.
So just... I have to say, well, I first time I met Mina, I don't think you remember. I was at in CERN on sabbatical, or visiting at CERN, and then I've heard this voice
from very quiet one, right?
Yes, a few offices down, few offices down, and always talking about something that looks always very exciting. And I couldn't manage to understand what was it. So I was trying to put something in my ears to see if I could follow it from my office, but I couldn't. And so I asked, who was this lady? Because I didn't know her. And then someone said, oh, just a student of Sabas. And Sabas is supposed to be here, but it's not here. Eh? Oh, there he is. So Sabas Dimopoulos is a great particle physics phenomenologist. He's one of the leaders in the field, from professor from Stanford. And they had this... Bone, I think, working with Mina at that time, they were always talking and doing something very, very, very interesting. And Sabas is very famous for having great collaborations and making big discoveries. And so Mina, I think, is one of the probably most recent and exciting students that Sabas has had. And so they're both here because we had an activity last week. And they decided to stay longer to have more collaboration with Giovanni here. And on their very short notice, we asked Mina if she could be willing to give a colloquium, and she was, as usually, very eager to say yes. And we are very thankful for her to accept to come here. And then she's just to let you know why she's so special is that. She's not only has a strong background in theoretical physics and is very leader in phenomenology, she has done work from supersymmetry to axiom physics to cosmology to black holes, even now leading some experimental initiatives. So you can see she's one of these very rich and broad physicists. So it's always a pleasure to have and listen and learn from her. So I'm sure you will enjoy the colloquium, and let's welcome Mina for the colloquium.
Thank you, Fernando. Thank you for a wonderful introduction. Wow, that was amazing. It's always a great pleasure to visit ICTP. I have a great time here. So in this talk today, I will try to give you an overview of dark matter. Okay? We have 1 hour. Dark matter is a huge subject. Of course, I won't be able to cover everything. Okay? So that automatically implies that my talk will be biased. And it will be biased because I will end up talking to you about things that I'm interested in and I'm excited about. I try to keep the level of the talk to a level that I thought was elementary. But I really encourage you, especially students, if you have a question, just interrupt me and I will answer it right away. I prefer that you do it this way instead of me waiting to finish the entire talk, okay? So, when you look, one of the most fascinating things about the universe is that most of it is actually invisible to the human eye. What you see around you makes up only for 5% of the energy density of the universe. About roughly a 70%, grossly speaking, is what we call dark energy, or the cosmological constant, which is a big mystery, and it's actually one of the most one of the open questions in the field of cosmology and particle physics, and in theoretical physics in general. But what I will talk about, in fact, is something that a bit more, what theorists consider a bit more pedestrian, dark matter, which is a 25% of the energy density of the cosmos. And as the name calls it, it's a type of matter that does not interact with light. Okay? And if it doesn't interact with light, we know it's there through its gravitational interactions. These are observations that go back to the 1930s. So the first thing that, one of the first things that people observed is that if you see it here on the left, that if you measure the velocity of the stars inside galaxies as a function of the of the distance from the center of the galaxy, if you didn't have any dark matter, any type of hidden matter component, all you would observe is this orange curve. Okay, you were expecting something like this. But what people saw is this green curve here, meaning that things that are further away move faster than expected. So there is an additional component of matter that comes in as you go further away out of the galaxy. Okay? Now we have even more evidence. We know from the, there are evidence in dark matter, gravitational interactions on the cosmic microwave background, the light that came from the Big Bang. And we also have evidence from a very well-known effect in general relativity called gravitational lensing. If you have very strong gravity, light, even light, will bend around it. Okay? So if you have a very dense mass, galaxies in the universe, galaxies and stars that are behind it, the light will be curved. Okay? And you will see many images of the same object. Okay, this is gravitational lensing. And this is a picture that shows the results of a gravitational lensing analysis of the, on the bullet cluster. The bullet cluster is, in fact, two clusters that have collided long ago. And what they observed is that the first observed, of course, the visible matter, which is shown here in pink. And when they did gravitational lensing analysis, they found that most of the gravitating matter is this in these blue blobs. So what happens is, what the hypothesis happened is that the two clusters collided, the dark matter went off, and the light got stuck in the middle. The light matter, the visible matter, got stuck in the middle. So this is direct evidence that we have an additional component of matter. It's not just a modification of gravity. This is the most convincing evidence that we have so far. So now, as theorists, we want to understand what it is. So in particle physics, we'll build models of what dark matter may be. And in fact, for this, we have gazillions of ideas. It can be anything from an elementary particle. Dark matter can be anything from an elementary particle to black holes, primordial black holes, pieces of rock, what they call kind of like matches, things that you cannot observe with light, all sorts of crazy things, okay? Now, when we, the next thing, after you came up with an idea of what that dark matter can be, you have to ask yourself, how is it produced? One thing, how do you end up getting an abundance that it is what you measure, this 25%? And the other thing is, the other question you want to ask is, can I detect it? Does it have interactions with us, with the visible matter, the standard model particles, other than gravitational? And in fact, if you look at most of the theories that have been put on paper, they fail on the last two. Most of them fail on the last two. And there are a few candidates that satisfy all three requirements. One of them is what is called the WIMP. It's the weakly interacting massive particle. Okay? And this is a dark matter candidate that you may have heard about because it has become popular since the 80s. And there have been several experiments trying to find it. So how is the WIMP produced? So the WIMP is the particle, as the word says, is weakly interacted, meaning it has interactions with standard model fields that are of the strength of the weak interactions, of the force of that is mediated through the W and the Z bosons. Okay? So through this interaction, it was in thermal equilibrium in the early universe with standard model particles. And this is what this interaction shows. So you have two dark matter particles that, for example, can annihilate two standard model particles. So here in this diagram, I'm assuming time runs from left to right. And in the early universe, you could have both processes, standard model particles going back to dark matter going back to standard model particles, and everything what was called in thermal equilibrium. But as the universe cooled down, the density of particles was going down. And then it became, given that the interaction was so weak, it became harder for dark matter particles to find each other. And this is what is shown here in this plot. So this is the number of dark matter particles relative to the number of photons as a function of time in the universe. Initially, you see here this curved line is what that number would be if the particles were always in equilibrium. At some point, because the interactions are weak, is what happens is these interactions freeze out. And then you get, after that, after the interaction freezes out, the number density of the particles relative to the number of photons is kept fixed. And of course, as you can understand, the bigger the cross-section, the later the freeze-out happens, the later the dark matter decouples from us, and the less abundance you get. Now, if you were to convert the measured dark matter abundance to a cross-section, to say what cross-section would I need the dark matter to have to produce the dark matter abundance that I observe today, you see that this is a formula that naturally gives you the TeV scale. The TeV scale, this is the same scale that is probed by the Large Hadron Collider. Okay? So, this is also the same scale that is probed by direct detection experiments. Now let's take the same diagram. Remember, time is always running this way, from left to right. So let's take the diagram where dark matter particles were annihilated into standard model particles and turn it by 90 degrees. Then you can see that I can have a standard model particle scattering off a dark matter particle. Okay? This is a process that happens all the time if a WIMP is the dark matter candidate. So because we move through the Earth moves through the dark matter. So we can build a detector, put it in a lab or in a big mine, and wait for dark matter particles to come in and interact with our detector. And here you see, this is a plot that shows, unfortunately we haven't found anything. So this is a plot that shows the bound on the interaction cross-section between dark matter particles and standard model particles as a function of the dark matter mass. And you see here, this is in GeV. This is the TeV scale is right here. So this is the sweet spot that I was telling you before about thermal production. And as I said, there are several experiments. You see all these lines are different experiments. So there's tons of experiments that look for this. Unfortunately, they haven't found anything yet. Another kind of exciting prospect when you look for WIMPs is that you can also directly produce it. So again, the same diagram where dark matter was annihilating standard model particles, rotated by 180 degrees. Now you see that two standard model particles can collide to produce two dark matter particles. And because dark matter particles interact with us so weakly, it would mean that the standard model particles annihilate to invisible energy. So this is a process that you can look for at the Large Hadron Collider in Geneva, where protons are accelerated to very high energies and collided with each other. And this is a fact, one of the reasons, one of many reasons, that research at the Large Hadron Collider is so exciting. And in fact, in particle physics in general, for the past 50 years, great progress has come out of the Collider program. But we have to, if you look at the totality of the energy scales that we know of, There is so much left to explore, okay? So if you look from the biggest scale that we know of, the size of our universe, down to the Planck scale, what we know of, taking into account neutrinos and their masses, the dark energy, the standard model particles, and the energies produced by the LHC, they only cover 20% of this energy range. So we have 80% left to explore. What do you expect to find in this vast energy range? This is what is called usually the precision frontier, because the particles that you expect to find here are very weakly interacting with us. Take, for example, gravitons, the gravitational waves. You may have heard that advanced LIGO, an experiment that was 30 years in the making, recently saw the merger of two black holes. So those gravitational waves cannot be produced at colliders. You need a very sensitive probe, okay? So these experiments that I will be talking about go by the name, under the name, the big field of the precision frontier. Of course, as I said, LIGO is a great example of this. It's a great success story. It made us everyone excited this year. But there are several other ideas that come from other fields of physics that are a bit unusual for a particle physicist to think about. Take, for example, atom interferometry. In atom interferometry, they can manipulate the quantum state of an atom and then have demonstrated precision of one part in 10 to the 18. This is a billionth of a billionth, okay? This is an amazing level of precision. So there are several ideas out there that talk about how you can, for example, test gravity at short distance, at any distance. How you can perform new tests of gravity in the lab. How you can find new ways to build gravitational wave detectors at other frequencies different than LIGO. How you can look for an electric dipole moment from the neutron, for example. So for the rest of the talk, I will focus on one class of these ideas and talk about how these ideas, these new technologies, can be used to detect dark matter. Okay? And in particular, I will think about dark matter candidates that are much lighter than the WIMP that I talked about before. Okay? Just to give you an idea of the mass, I'll be talking about, the WIMP is roughly 100 to 1,000 times heavier than the proton. The dark matter candidates I'm going to be talking about are going to be 20 orders of magnitude lighter than the proton, or even lighter. These are particles that if you were to convert their size to a quantum their mass to a quantum wavelength to a size, they would be bigger than this room, or bigger than the solar system. Okay? And these particles are elementary and they can be the dark matter. They naturally arise in a variety of theories that we have built for beyond the standard model. They go by funny names. They call them axions out of a detergent band. They call them the dilaton. They call them moduli. And in particular, in string theory, these moduli are the fields, the particles, that determine the values of the fundamental constants that we measure in the standard model. For example, these are fields whose properties determine what the strength of the electromagnetic interaction is, what the strength of the strong interaction is, what the electron Yukawa is, what the top Yukawa is. And this tells you automatically now that what you thought was fundamental constants, when you think about constants, you think, oh, there must be constants. Well, in fact, because they depend on these fields, they are not really constants. And this is the important thing to remember. This is exactly what happens if these fields are, in fact, the dark matter of the universe. Okay? So I've been meddling a bit with mixing the concept of a particle and a field. So I would like to explain to you how that can arise. So now the reason you may be confused when I talk about particles and fields is that when you think about the dark matter in the galaxy, the first picture that comes to mind is something like this. You imagine that there are these dark little balls of particles that are bouncing around each other, bouncing around us without us knowing. And it's more like a picture of particles in a gas. in reality, what happens is what quantum mechanics tells us we should be thinking about is this. Okay? Particles are equivalent to waves. These waves have a characteristic size set by the de Broglie wavelength. So it's inversely, the size is inversely proportional to the mass and inversely proportional to their velocity. Okay? So for a WIMP and in the galaxy, these two descriptions, because these waves have a tiny, tiny size, these two descriptions are equivalent. You don't have to worry. For all practical purposes, they are the same thing. But a special thing happens when I start considering particles that are as big as this room. So what happens is, as I start decreasing the mass, because I keep fixed the dark matter density, the number density of particles needs to increase. So these waves, initially they were far apart, and now these wave packets are coming together. Okay? And eventually they're overlapping. For fermions, for particles that have half-integer spin, this is a big no-no, because Pauli's exclusion principle tells you that they cannot occupy the same space and time. But for scalars, you can keep piling them on. So when you do that, when this picture is true, you are not, it's better to describe dark matter not as particles, but as a field, as a wave. A wave that is trapped inside the galaxy, okay? As I said, this transition happens when the number density of dark matter particles becomes larger than the inverse cubic power of the de Broglie wavelength. So you can fit more than one particle per de Broglie wavelength cubed. So if you run the numbers for the current density that we know of in the galaxy, it happens for dark matter masses lighter than an EV. This is a billion times lighter than the proton. Okay? So this field, you can think about it being trapped in the galaxy. It has an amplitude and a frequency. The amplitude is proportional to the square root of the dark matter density and inversely proportional to the dark matter mass. You can think about it this way because this finite is like setting the number density of particles. So given that I have a fixed dark matter density, the lighter I make the particle, the more particles I need. And the frequency is roughly set by the dark matter mass. So for a particle that's, let's say, as big as, that's roughly a kilometer, that's the size of a kilometer, let's say the distance between here and downtown Trieste, this is a frequency of about a kilohertz, just to give you an idea. And the other thing to remember, this is not a perfect wave. This is not a wave that's monochromatic. There is a spread in the frequencies that's set by the trapping velocity of that the trapped particle, because this dark matter is trapped in the galaxy, there's what is called the virial velocity, which is the velocity of particles that are gravitationally bound to the galaxy. And that's roughly 10 to the minus 3 of the speed of light, telling you that the spread in frequencies is 1 millionth of the nominal frequency. So this is an oscillation that remains coherent for 10 to the 6 periods. I spend a lot of time explaining why the WIMP is a good dark matter count and how is it produced. And for these particles, I didn't say anything. In fact, as I said, these are also great dark matter candidates because we know of a way to produce them. So if you look at the evolution of the universe, this is a plot that shows the size of the universe as a function of time. Okay, now it's here at around 10 to the 18 seconds or 10 billion years. There is a period where the universe, if you've taken a course in cosmology, where the universe exponentially increased its size. This is what we called inflation. So quantum fluctuations during inflation, just gravitational quantum fluctuations during inflation, produce this particle. The WIMPs, on the other hand, just to compare, this is very early on the edge of the universe, where the universe was almost a Planck time old. Okay? If you look at the time where the WIMPs were produced, they were produced much, much later if you had a WIMP dark matter candidate. So to go a bit more detail on this, so I was talking about a field. So when you think about a field, there is always a potential associated with it, similar to electromagnetism. Okay? For these scalar fields, this potential is just m squared times the field squared. It's its mass. So it's very similar to kx squared, the potential of a harmonic oscillator. So what inflation does for you, it displaces this harmonic oscillator, but it gives it random kicks and displaces it from the minimum. So after the end of inflation, you expect this field to be found somewhere up in its potential, displaced from the minimum. So there is actually a lot of energy stored in this field. So, and this continues to be the case. This energy stored that's stored in this field remains constant till the Hubble rate, till the size of the universe, let's say it this way, till the size of the universe becomes bigger than the size of this field, than the inverse mass of this field. Okay? When that happens, the energy density starts getting diluted exactly like a dark matter should. Dark matter candidate should. And after that, the energy density, as the universe expands, starts oscillating around, as I said, with the frequency of the mass. And the amplitude of the oscillation gets damped because the universe expands, so the number density of particles goes down. Okay? So today, there is a very small amplitude of oscillation. And if I were to measure this amplitude in Planck units, which is some random unit, but I picked it, well, it's not really random because I will be comparing the coupling strength of this particle to gravity. You find that this coupling, the amplitude of the oscillation relative to the Planck scale is 1 part in 10 to the 13. For a particle that has a mass of 10 to the minus 18 eV, if you convert it in hertz, this is roughly 1 millihertz in frequency. Okay? So how do we know it's there? So this is where the idea, we go back to the idea that these particles are fields like moduli that can couple to us. And they can determine the values of the fundamental constants. So, for example, take a field that can couple to the electron. So it determines the value of the electron mass. Because now this field is locally oscillating, it means that this oscillation is communicated to the electron. So the electron mass is now locally oscillating. Okay? So if you assume that the coupling strength of this field is the same as the coupling strength of gravity, you get that the amplitude of this oscillation equates the amplitude of oscillation of dark matter. So it's 6 times 10 to the minus 13. It oscillates with a dark matter mass frequency. And here, as I said, D is the coupling strength relative to gravity. Okay? So even if I have a field that locally couples with the strength of gravity and creates this tiny, tiny oscillation of the electron mass. For example, it doesn't have to be just the electron mass. It can be the strength of the electromagnetic interactions. It can be the quark masses, meaning the proton mass. It can be anything that you would consider a measured constant. Okay? And of course, as you can see, this is a tiny, tiny number. So you need a very, very sensitive probe of this effect. So... So this is the, yes? Sorry. No, this is the, so this oscillation loses coherence after 10 to the 6 periods. And this 10 to the 6 is the minimum coherence this oscillation can have. Because this comes out if you were to decompose the modes of the dark matter field in momentum modes and add them incoherently in the galaxy, this is what you would get. So I start measuring today, I see all the waves going in phase. After the 10 to the 6 period, they go out of phase, so I have to start the measurement over again. Does it make sense? So this is just a parenthesis. These particles that I've, these fields or particles that I've been talking about so far, they are already known. And these are things that people have been looking for when they look for modifications of gravity at short distances, fifth force experiments. Or they can also cause the rate of different composition objects, the falling rate on Earth of different composition objects to be different. This is what they call equivalence principle violation. And in fact, it's one of the oldest experiments that was ever performed by Galileo on the Tower of Pisa. But what is new in what I'm talking about is, in fact, that no one has considered the possibility that these particles can be dark matter and the ways to detect them. So given that I'm going to be talking about such tiny variations of fundamental constant, I need a very sensitive probe. So the first class of experiments I'm going to be talking about are based on atomic clocks, which are the current standard of time. And for the second part of my talk, I talk about another very sensitive probe, which is gravitational wave detectors, a class of gravitational wave detectors that are known as resonant mass detectors. As I said, dark matter causes fundamental constants to oscillate. If I have an atom that has discrete energy levels, the values of the energy levels depend on those fundamental constants. So if the fundamental constants oscillate, the energy levels or the energy splittings of the atom will oscillate. So the types of energy splitting that atomic clocks observe are optical splittings, what are called optical splittings, that are energy splittings of order of an EV or a Rydberg. The hyperfine splittings, which are the energy splitting resulting from the interaction between the spin of the protons of the nucleons in the nuclei and the orbital motion of the electrons around them, which are a million times smaller. And the other type is nuclear splittings, because nuclei are a bound state of nucleons, so those have discrete energy levels as well, with characteristic energy splittings of 1 MeV, okay? 10 to the 6 times bigger than visible light. So this is a picture of a... So in these experiments, they consider atoms, different types of atoms, and then let's say they look at excitations around the ground state, okay? So... Now I would like to spend some time explaining to you what are atomic clocks. Atomic clocks are really cool, first of all. They set the current standard of time. So the current definition of a second is defined as 9,192,631,770 periods of the cesium atomic clock. Okay? And this is actually quite an old definition. In fact, the cesium clock right now is not the most sensitive clock. They know they have atoms that are stable from in one part in 10 to the 18. Okay? This means that they can lose 1 second every 10 billion years. Okay? This is how stable these things are. And now this gives you an idea of how sensitive it is. If I were to, before I was showing you some numbers about the effect of dark matter that you would expect, and you see that I was telling you about one part in 10 to the 13. So this is actually a much more sensitive probe than what I was showing before. And of course, the other impressive thing is that this is a field that's booming, and the past 20 years, the people in this field have won many Nobel Prizes. So, how does it work? So what they do in these experiments, they take an atom and they look at a specific excitation of this atom. The way they do it is they shine a laser on this atom and they tune the frequency of the laser so that it excites resonantly the atom, okay? So when this happens, when the laser is precisely tuned, you see the atoms fluoresce, they shine, because they get de-excited. You are exactly on resonance. So now they try to measure the frequency of this laser. So how well can you determine the frequency of this laser depends on the properties of the atom now, because the properties of the laser are directly linked to the properties of the atom. So this is the accuracy in the frequency, and quantum mechanics tells us that if you have an atom that has a certain lifetime, a decay rate gamma, I cannot measure the frequency of the photon that's emitted better than this decay rate. Okay? This is just the uncertainty principle of quantum mechanics. So for these atoms that they use, because the decay rates are so small, the states are so long-lived, if you take the ratio between the decay rate of the atom over the frequency, you get a number of 10 to the minus 16. So you directly see where the great accuracy of these things comes from. The other thing that's important, of course, is how many times do I observe the atom? Okay? And this is just has to do with same thing we do when you do a lab experiment, how many it improves, my sensitivity improves, with the square root of the number of measurements I make. So if I were to observe n atoms at the same time, the sensitivity would improve like 1 over square root of n. And it will also improve by how many times I observe the same ensemble of atoms, which is the square root of this tau cycling over t experiment. T experiment is how long do I run the experiment for? How long do I have funding to run my experiment? And tau cycling is how long does it take to observe this atom? How long does a single measurement take? And in fact, it's a time scale of order the lifetime of the atom, of this excited state. Okay? So, of course, the reality is not that simple. So, in fact, in order to reject systematics, experimental systematics, you always have to compare two different clocks at the same time. Okay? Just to reject systematics. Now, the energy levels of these two different atoms depend differently on fundamental parameters, fundamental constants. So if I were to take the ratio of these two frequencies and I have a dark matter candidate that makes this fundamental constant vary, that makes these frequencies vary, because of this difference between the different species of atoms, the effect of the dark matter will remain and will appear as an oscillation of the of the ratio of the frequencies of the atoms. Is that clear? So I have two different atoms. For each atom, dark matter will make the levels oscillate. Okay? But because the atoms are different, the amplitude of the oscillation is different. Okay? One may go, they may all go, even go out of phase. So if I were to take the ratio of these two frequencies, I would still see the oscillation. The oscillation will be left over. Okay? And then I take my measurement as often as I can. And then I take, I run the experiment as long as I can. Okay? And then I have a timestamp to calculate the frequency ratio at 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, all the way up to a year. And then I take the Fourier transform of this data. Once I take the Fourier transform, what I try to see is a peak should appear. If there is a signal from dark matter, there should be a peak that tells me that there is an oscillation at the frequency of the dark matter. Okay? So it also tells you that these clocks can scan many frequencies, many periods at the same, at one time. And this is a table. This is nothing to, you can ignore most of the centers of this table. This is a table of the types of atoms that they use. They use cesium, as I said, mercury, ytterbium, aluminum, strontium, dysprosium, and thallium. Okay, these are the most popular things. You see here, this is the long-term stability, how stable these things are. And this is, you see here, in particular, the ytterbium clock is stable at 1 part in 10 to the 18, as I told you before. So these two columns here, these zetas and xis, tell you how the frequency varies when the different fundamental constants vary. Okay? And these are just some numbers that are calculated. So Now, notice all these atomic numbers of these atoms are huge. We're talking about atomic numbers 170, close to 200. Because you have so many electrons bound to a single atom, crazy things happen. So for the dysprosium, there is a dysprosium clock where they can build different clocks from two different isotopes of dysprosium, which are supposed to be optical clocks, meaning the wavelength of the radiation emitted is around a micron. But in fact, when they measure it, they found it to be closer to 10 to the 5 microns, which is radio. Okay? And the reason is, in dysprosium, there is an accidental cancellation between contributions, relativistic contributions in the motion of the electrons around the atom, because there are so many atoms, so many electrons. So even though the stability of the dysprosium clock is nowhere as good as the other clocks, they are very sensitive probes of dark matter. Because, for example, imagine in this optical clock, if you were to compare it to dysprosium clocks, if I were, let's imagine I have a dark matter that causes the fine structure constant to oscillate. If I were to translate what that oscillation would be in an oscillation of the energy level of the dysprosium, I would find a coefficient of 10 to the 6 in front of it. So any small variation of fundamental constant is enhanced by this accidental cancellation by a factor of 10 to the 6. A similarly amazing thing happens for thorium. Thorium is a nuclear clock. It hasn't been built yet. It's theorized. So there is an excitation of the thorium nucleus that has an energy of 7 eV, which is optical. It's very UV, but it's optical, okay? For nuclei, the characteristic energy splitting is big MeV. So here in the thorium, there is an accident, because the nucleus is so large, there is an accidental cancellation between the contributions to the binding energy of the strong interactions and the electromagnetic interactions. So if I had the fine structure constant change by amount 1, this energy splitting of the thorium will be changed by a factor of 10 to the 5, okay? Due to this accidental cancellation. So makes it a very sensitive probe. So given all these things, what type of comparisons can they do to disentangle the effects of dark matter? So if you were to compare a hyperfine clock to a clock based on optical transitions, you would be sensitive to dark matter fields that cause either the electron mass, the quark masses, mainly the proton mass, and the strength of the strong interactions to change. If I were to compare two different optical clocks, I would become sensitive to variations of the fine structure constant, the strength of the electromagnetic interactions. And if I were to measure a nuclear transition to an atomic transition, any atomic transition, optical transition in particular, I would be sensitive to all sorts of variations that can be caused from dark matter. Okay? And this is a plot that shows the reach of these comparisons for a specific case as a function of the dark matter mass. So this here, this plot, this x-axis is the dark matter mass in EV. Up here you can see what this mass corresponds to in frequency. This y-axis is the coupling strength of the dark matter relative to gravity. And for simplicity purposes, I have assumed that this dark matter couples to the fine structure constant, what I call DE here, okay? So zero, this is a log scale, so zero is 1 times gravity. When you see here 10 to the minus 15, minus 15 is 10 to the minus 15 weaker than gravity, many, many orders of magnitude. So the gray stuff is what is excluded already from laboratory searches, from searches for modifications of gravity. This green stuff you just ignore because it's a theoretical prejudice, so you don't have to worry about it. And the interesting thing is this purple. The purple thing is what was the result of just data reanalysis. So after we published the paper, saying that dark matter can be looked for in oscillation of atomic energy levels. The Butker group from Berkeley contacted us and said, hey, we have this data from dysprosium that we took over a period of 4 months. Do you think we can use it? So we said, sure, and Ken van Tilburg, who is a very smart student and collaborator of mine on this work, now he's a postdoc, actually, did this Fourier analysis of the data. This is just data that were taken over 2 weeks, and then they waited 4 months, and then they took some data. So this took the Fourier transform of this data, and they managed to do, they of course, they didn't find anything, but it would have been lucky, it would have been great. But they did manage to improve on current searches by several orders of magnitude, okay? The other darker purple, this is a curve from another group in France that also reanalyzed existing data. So the point of this curve is that what we proposed can be done, doesn't require any much extra effort, it just requires looking at your data again with a different eye, because the technology is already there. And you can improve on current dark matter searches very easily and very quickly. The future, of course, okay, this is all great, but the question is how do we improve on this? And the great improvement comes if someone were to build a thorium clock, a nuclear clock. Those clocks will be extremely stable, and in fact, they could be extremely sensitive to this type of dark matter candidate. So you see here, you see a similar plot as before. This is the dark matter mass. This is the corresponding frequency of the signal. This is the coupling strength of dark matter relative to gravity when it couples to the proton mass. Okay, and you see here the blue curves. The solid blue curves is what can be done now. Already now, this is, you cannot really see it, the exclusion from current experiments. Already with current capabilities, you can improve on current searches by several orders of magnitude. But if you were to build a nuclear clock, you can improve by 12 orders of magnitude. Okay? So it's an extremely sensitive probe. This is just a last thing. Even in the future, so I was talking about comparing different clocks, but you can also compare the same clocks separated in space. Okay? And what you do to do that, you measure the clocks with the same laser. Because the laser takes a certain time to reach the atoms, the two different atoms that are spatially separated, the value of dark matter that they observe is different. Okay, so there is still an effect, and it's quite sensitive. Just to summarize, what I describe is a new dark matter search based on well-established technology that can improve dark matter searches by several orders of magnitude, and it has great potential for improvements in the future. Okay. Now, of course, this is not the only way you can probe such types of dark matter. Another way is the following. So I said about how if you have an oscillation, the fundamental constant, it causes the energy level of the atoms to oscillate. Those oscillation of fundamental constants can also cause something else. They can make the size of the atom change. So if you have, because the size of the atom is inversely proportional to the electron mass and the fine structure constant, if the electron mass changes or the fine structure constant changes, that means the strength of the electromagnetic interactions, then it can become smaller or bigger. Okay? By how much? Well, that's a tiny thing. If for a single atom, the numbers that I'm going to be talking about, we're talking about the change in size on one part in what do I have here? 10 to the minus 30 meters. The size of a nucleus is 10 to the minus 15 meters. So we're talking about something essentially unobservable, right? But the great thing is if you go to a solid, the atoms are stacked next to each other. So in a solid, this tiny effect of 10 to the minus 30 is enhanced by the Avogadro number, which is a number of 10 to the 23. So it makes it observable. So when this happens, when I have a dark matter that changes the size of the atoms, everything changes with it. So the Earth changes with it, we change with it, so everything breathes with the dark matter. Of course, by an amount that's, it won't make us dizzy, of course, and depends on the frequency, but it's amazing to think that the dark matter, and it's very weak, so it doesn't cause anything, but we vibrate with the dark matter, in a sense, okay? Now, what is the most sensitive probe of this effect? So given that I'm talking about the breathing, I'm talking about an oscillation, let's think, go back and think about a simple harmonic oscillator, okay? So I have a mass connected to a spring that has a resonant frequency omega and an equilibrium length L, okay? And I can imagine I apply a constant force, I can also apply random thermal forces on it, and this is the equation of motion. This Q factor here is what is called the quality factor and quantifies how imperfect my harmonic oscillator is. It's the loss factor. So now let's imagine that let's go to a reference frame that moves with my harmonic oscillator. So I make a change of reference frames and I sit on the mass, okay? Now, if there is a dark matter, as I said, it will change the size of this harmonic oscillator. What it does, in fact, it changes the equilibrium size of this harmonic oscillator, okay? So this L parameter is what oscillates in time. So if I make this change of variables, I can rewrite my equation of motion, and I see now that a new term has appeared. The new term that has appeared here is like a restoring force. And it's proportional to the second derivative of the variation of the equilibrium length of the mass. Okay? So now let's assume that this variation is a harmonic variation. It has one frequency. Then this force is proportional to the mass times the frequency squared times the equilibrium length times the amplitude of the variation, okay, this h. So this is a formula that appears also in gravitational wave detection. This is a force that's applied in a solid when a gravitational wave passes by, okay? So now, if I were to make this frequency match the resonant frequency of my harmonic oscillator, I can drive it in resonance. So I make a big vibration out of a small effect. And this is the idea, this is what we call, we drive the harmonic oscillator on resonance. So this is the idea, actually, that Weber had in the 60s to detect gravitational wave radiation. So this is the first, in fact, gravitational wave detector ever built. He claimed to have detected gravitational waves, which proved to be false. But his technique, the Weber bar as it is known, his technique has been improved over the years. They didn't abandon the technology. And in fact, two of the currently running Auriga and Nautilus are based in Italy, one in Padova, the other in, I think it's in Frascati, could be wrong, that can measure small vibrations of these objects at a level, small changes in length at the level of one part in 10 to the 23. Okay? This is an unprecedented level of precision. So, so this is just by measuring the resonant excitations, the resonant vibrations that are induced by the dark matter or a gravitational wave passing through this bar. So just to give you an idea of the parameters, if you have a meter-sized object, the resonant frequency of such an object, the note at which it vibrates, is 1 kilohertz. This is something that is audible to the human ear. And in fact, if you go to the Advanced LIGO website that just detected gravitational waves, the gravitational waves of that experiment are in those frequencies between 20 hertz and 1 kilohertz. So in fact, they have converted the gravitational wave signal in something that you can actually hear. Okay? That's why we, in fact, this is the reason why we even call this experiment the sound of dark matter, because in these frequencies you can even hear it. For gravitational waves, when they look for gravitational waves, they have a pretty good idea of what frequencies they should be looking at, because they know what gravitational wave frequencies they expect from astrophysical sources. But for dark matter, this is not the case. I showed you a plot of dark matter masses that spans decades in energy. So we need to find a way to look for other higher frequencies, and the way you do that, instead of just looking at one fundamental vibrational mode, you look at many. Cute fact, we are actually sitting on a very good resonant mass detector. The Earth itself, they've discovered, has vibrational modes that have frequencies around the period of around 28 minutes that get excited during earthquakes. And they measured them, they measured the vibrations, and they saw that it took about 10 to the 4 oscillations for them to be dumbed down. Basically, they were measuring them for months. After one of these huge earthquakes, the Earth was vibrating for months. So you can convert what we have measured with seismographs into a bound on dark matter, okay? And you can see actually that the Earth as a gravitational waves detector is not that bad, or a dark matter detector is not that bad. It's sensitive to variations in one part in 10 to the 17th. You can use other astrophysical objects. The sun is one object you can use this for. The moon, okay? The only problem is that you can only use them for bounds. But even so, this is a plot that shows, again, similar as before, this is dark matter mass. This is coupling strength of dark matter, either to the fine structure constant or to the electron mass, as a function of the dark matter mass. And you see here, this very narrow line is the bound that can be derived from the vibrations of the Earth. It's one mode, but in that one mode, the Earth does better than any experiment that we know of. Okay? Any experiment that we have ever constructed in the lab. So these other curves up here are either existing, this Auriga experiment or this Quartz experiment, of what experiments can do now. And this blue and pink are what can be done in the future. Okay? And as I said, this is a very well-established technology. The Auriga collaboration recently published their exclusion bound for this type of dark matter candidates. But as you can see, you can improve. There is a lot of future. There is a lot to be done, left to be done. So time is getting late, and I have to finish. I want to now completely switch gears and talk about, not about how we can detect dark matter in the lab, but how we can detect perhaps a dark matter candidate using black holes, okay? And many of you may have been here on Friday. Savas Dimopoulos gave a very nice talk on this subject. So, and because of time, I have to go through over it very fast. Black holes have a characteristic size, okay? That's set by the size of the horizon. It's the distance from which light can no longer escape the gravitational pull of the black hole. For black holes that are in our universe, this size is somewhere between a kilometer for black holes that are the product of the collapse of stars, up to 10 billion kilometers, which are the supermassive black holes that you find them in the center of galaxies. And as I said, I've been talking so far about particles whose size can be a kilometer, can be as big as the universe. So you can have a situation where you can have a particle that has a similar size to the size of a black hole, an astrophysical black hole. And of course, as I said many times, this is extremely exciting because we now know that black holes are definitely there. Okay? It's almost a year now. In a few days, it's going to be the yearly anniversary of the discovery of the first gravitational black hole merger from Advanced LIGO. So this is a field that's currently emerging, and it's happening, and we'll have lots of data. And this is something else. So it will give us ideas about where, how black holes are born. It will give us ideas about how the universe was created. But now, through this process that I'm going to be talking about, it will also, these black holes can also tell us about the presence of new particles that can be the dark matter of the universe. I don't have time to go over the details. This is something that is called superradiance, black hole superradiance. It's known in general relativity since the 60s and the 70s, and the effect goes as follows. If you have a dark matter particle that matches, that is close to the size of an astrophysical black hole, it doesn't have to be the dark matter, then this particle will form a bound state with a black hole, okay? And because of the effect of the superradiance, the number of particles that occupy this bound state will grow exponentially. So what will happen if you have a rotating black hole, the black hole has to be rotating, what will happen is the black hole will spin down and it will populate these bound states with an exponentially large number of particles. If you look at the property of this cloud of particles, you will see that it greatly resembles the property of a hydrogen atom. It's just that the only difference is now that the binding strength is gravity, okay? And of course, we're talking about, instead of talking about something that's an angstrom in size, which is 10 to the minus 10 meters, we're talking about something that's 10 to the 13 times bigger than this. Can be as big as a kilometer, right? Or even bigger. And if you calculate how many particles you can have occupying these bound states, you find that, in fact, the number of particles can be bigger than if you were to count the total number of protons that you find in stars in the universe. So we're talking about, this is a number more than 10 to the 77, 10 to the 80. Cannot even imagine how big this is. The great thing about it is that this cloud doesn't stay still. It emits gravitational waves, and the principle behind the emission of these gravitational waves is the same behind what is behind the principle of a laser. So this cloud of particles emits very monochromatic radiation that can be detectable at Advanced LIGO. Okay, it's getting very late. So to summarize, I believe the best motivated candidates in particle, dark matter candidates in particle physics are elementary particles. They can either be WIMPs, or they can be these very light dark matter particles that I talked about today. In fact, in the latter case, there are several ways, new ways to detect them. That I described based on atomic clocks, gravitational wave detectors, even black holes. But I truly believe that there are so many more ideas out there that we haven't even yet thought of. In fact, it's good to keep an open mind. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Amina. Such a wonderful talk. So it's covered everything, so I'm sure there will be many questions.
Even if you think you're confused, don't be shy. Yes?
Sara?
I don't know exactly how to ask a question, but yeah. Is there an idea if this dark matter has some scale of dishomogeneity in the...
In homogeneity?
Yeah.
Yeah, so of course you need the dark matter to be homogeneous to form structures. So there is over densities of dark matter in the galaxy, which is more dense than the cluster,
so
right?
The scale is the same as follows the same
Yeah, it's similar scale, yes. So there is something that is related to what you're asking that has to do with the coherence length of the dark matter. So I talked about an oscillation that it's coherent for 10 to the 6 periods, but the question is if I start moving my detector, I start separating my detectors, when do I see my detectors going out of phase, which is the coherence length? And that's directly related to the de Broglie wavelength. So for these things, this is also macroscopic. This is very huge. So you can think of it as this one scale of inhomogeneity of sorts, okay, for these guys.
Questions?
I'd like to take you back to the first part of your lecture.
Okay.
Yeah. You gave two justifications for the existence of dark matter, which was gravitational lensing and the velocities of the stars in the galaxies.
Yes.
Is there, when you take a given galaxy and you compare the predicted mass from gravitational lensing and that of that from looking at the velocity
rotational curves, do they agree? Yeah, I think that they do. I think this I haven't. That's an excellent question, and I think these measurements have been done, and the amount of dark matter predict these measurements agree with each other in general.
They agree.
Yeah, okay. to what some accuracy, of course, right? So in general, they
agree. If the deviations are large, then
of course, this is an excellent question. You know, you have a different explanation for different effects. But it looks like everything is comparable. In fact, even from the CMB, the number that you get, you need many measurements to take that into account. Yes, so, yeah.
Questions? Let me ask a question myself, but people get wrong. When you were discussing about the scalar particles to be dark matter very light ones, there is a difference if they are pseudoscalars or scalars?
No, for this, no.
So all the things you say applies to axion-like?
All the things apply. What changes, of course, is the way they couple to us, right? If it's a pseudoscalar, you assume it has it's odd in parity, so it can have only derivative couplings in principle.
Mm-hmm.
So the couplings that I'm talking about are scalar couplings that break a shift symmetry. So.
Well, the fact that all the coupling constants, like the finite structure constant. So
that won't
oscillate.
Be in principle caused by pseudoscalar particle like the axion, mm-hmm. but in the presence of CP violation, axions can have scalar couplings that break the shift symmetry. So those will cause oscillation of the class that I'm talking about. But it requires additional CP violation of the theory. So now it's not really a pseudoscalar particle, it's a mixture of both.
Okay, very good. Yeah. And in your plots, you usually stop around 10 to the minus 24 electron volts.
Yes.
Why is that?
Because there is a bound on the how light a dark matter particle can be based on structure formation. As I said, as dark matter becomes lighter, it becomes bigger and bigger. At some point, you cannot fit it in dwarf galaxies. So there is a lower bound on the mass of the scalar dark matter mass you can have if you wanted to produce the structure that you observe. So it's roughly between 10 to the minus 24 and 10 to the minus 23, and it assumes that this scalar dark matter candidate is all of the dark matter. Okay? If it's 10% of the dark matter or even a smaller fraction, it can still be fine at all ranges, right?
Okay.
Yeah.
And the fact that you have some horizontal lines and then the slope
That's another good question, but I didn't go too much in detail. So let me go here, for example. Here. So you see here that as the dark matter mass decreases, the sensitivity goes up. And the reason is that as the dark matter mass decreases, the coherent time of oscillation goes up. So I can integrate coherently my signal for longer times. Now, this continues till you reach at some point the oscillation taking longer than a single oscillation taking longer than the duration of the experiment. So you don't gain anymore because you cannot see the full oscillation after that. So this is why it flattens out. In fact, the more accurate depiction, it's not really flat. it's in reality should go up because it decouples, right?
Okay, if people don't have more questions, I have more, so let me continue.
Yeah.
people have been talking about that, and now primordial black holes can still be good candidates for dark matter.
Yeah.
Can you comment on that?
Look, I'm not an expert on this. There is Mark Amyokovsky who is studying this. So the statement is that you could have, let's say, 30 solar mass primordial black holes be the dark matter of the universe. In principle, there appears to be a measurement from the CMB distortion that excludes this possibility. But according to Mark, it's not clear they've done the analysis properly. Basically, you have these primordial black holes and they accrete matter in the early universe where it's much denser. So you start emitting X-rays. So they distort the microwave spectrum. It's not clear because they made some assumptions about accretion. The other thing, I don't know if this bound applies. Mark is looking into it, Mark Amyokovsky. So the other thing is, what is the merger rate, right? How often is it that you will see the merger of this object, either the primordial black holes or the primordial black hole and neutron stars? So these are also highly uncertain.
Okay. Because that would be very important, because if they are... So you don't need to go beyond the standard model.
Sure. That would be
scary.
If you were to see dark matter, trust me, I spoke about my favorite dark matter candidates, but before to identify what the dark matter is, nobody would complain.
Okay, so there are no more questions. So let me just see how we want to proceed, because we have 37 new students, and we warned them that there will be some refreshments outside, but only for everybody else, not for the students at the moment, because the students will come down and ask questions to Mina just in private, so that you don't feel shy to ask questions. And then we promise you that there will be some of the refreshments left over after you question Mina. And you can ask her any questions you want.
So, you can ask me any question you want.
So details about the talk or the things that she mentioned that you probably don't know what it is. So for instance, what is the Planck scale or what is the CMB or etc. So anything you want. So at the moment, before we leave, let's thank Mina again.